Hi, I'm Paul Joy. In this video, I'm going to show you how I fly a drone from a moving ship. Okay, so let's talk about some of the differences between maybe filming from a smaller boat and a bigger ship. Now, with a smaller boat, if you've got the ability to stop the boat while you're filming, it makes it a lot easier. And also, you've got the ability to maneuver the boat, so that if something were to happen with the drone, you can go and catch it or rescue it. Now, when working on a big boat, that's really not an option. You can't stop it, and there's no way you could possibly go back or ask the captain to do anything other than follow his set route. So that with it brings quite a few challenges. So I'm going to go through those now and just talk to you about what I have done to try and minimize the risks as much as possible. Okay, so to start off with, then there's a few basic things obviously to consider. If you're going to be working somewhere where there's members of the public, the first thing you need to do is find an area to work, to operate the drone from, where there won't be any people. You have to bear a few things in mind on a ship as well. You've got multiple decks, so even though you might have a clear deck for your operation, there may be people in the decks above or below which could come close to the drone. So doing this requires working with the captain and working with the cruise line to make sure that when you're operating, it really is safe and there's not going to be anyone around. Now, obviously, you need to have permission from the cruise line to do this. Most cruise lines don't allow them, so please don't do this if you're just a passenger on a ship. So the other thing to consider is privacy. You don't want to be intruding on anyone's privacy, so you have to bear that in mind and keep the drone at a good distance from the ship in order to maintain people's privacy. Okay, so assuming you've got permission to operate, the next thing you need to think about is the safety of the drone as well as the passengers. Now, you're going to be flying a drone in a really full-on situation, so you need to make sure that you've got people with you to help. Probably two people, one person to help as a spotter, to have an eye on the drone the whole time, even when you're looking away, if you're checking settings or looking at composing your shot. Someone needs to have eyes on that drone, so that's really important. But you also need somebody else with you as well, just to handle any incursions by guests or crew even. If someone comes in and starts getting a bit too close to your operation, or they're in an area where they could be putting themselves into danger, then you need somebody to talk to them and be able to manage that without interrupting you or the person helping you to fly. One of the things you can do to minimize the risk of uninvolved people getting too close is to operate in the early hours of the mornings. So for instance, we were flying the drone just after sunrise. Really, that was lovely light. Most people were still asleep anyway, so that really minimized any risks, and it's something you really want to think about if you're going to be doing something similar. So the next thing to look at is finding somewhere suitable to fly the drone from. Ideally, there'll be an area with a little bit of deck space where you can launch and maybe even land. I mean, I was hand catching the drone, but still it's nice to have a little bit of room to maneuver when you're coming in to land. So the other thing to consider is having a good look around the area where you're going to be operating to check how the wind is moving. There could be a still spot where you're standing, but you know, 10 feet to your left or 10 feet to your right, it could get really windy all of a sudden. So it's worth just having a look around, really checking how the wind is going to be moving around that part of the ship. It's super important that you know which direction the wind is blowing in and also how that relates to the direction of the ship. For instance, if the boat is traveling at 10 knots and the wind is blowing in the opposite direction at 10 miles an hour, you could be facing 20 mile an hour winds or more, which could be more than your drone can handle.
What do you think of the conditions, Pete?
I think it's too windy. It's too windy.
I hear you.
Quite often ships will have quite large radar domes, maybe radio transmission signals as well, and they can interfere with your drone. Now, I didn't find that it interfered at all with the control of my drone, but one thing it did do was cause some breakup in the video signal, and I found that my range before I'd start to get breakup in the video signal was much reduced over normally, say, working inland. So that's something to bear in mind as well. So the next thing to think about is what drone you're going to use. Now, I chose to use the Phantom 4. This is the Phantom 4 Pro Obsidian. Now, why did I choose this? Well, three main reasons, really. The first is the landing feet. I mean, this is a really easy drone to hand catch. And flying from a ship, that's a real help. Secondly, the quality of this is really good. I mean, it's not up to the level of the Inspire, but nonetheless, it's certainly good enough for the task that I was looking to do. The third reason is that this can be switched to ATI mode using the controller, and that's really important for flying from anything which is moving, because you can't rely on keeping the drone stable using GPS. You do not want the drone to hold its position in space at all. Now, it's worth considering that you really need to be used to using ATI mode before doing anything like operating from a ship. Basically, in ATI mode, the drone will drift with the wind. It'll literally just hold its altitude. So it's a good skill to have, but it's a definitely must-have for working on a ship. And the drone is programmed to maintain its position using GPS. And the first thing that's going to happen when you lift off is the drone is going to fly to that position. And that's how a lot of people lose their drones. They'll fly into the handrail. You know, you see all these videos on YouTube of drones hitting the handrail and tipping into the sea. That's why. That's because people have not been using ATI mode. They've been leaving it in GPS, taking off, and the drone's confused. So the first thing it does is think it's drifting in the wind and tries to fly back to that position. And one thing to bear in mind I found with the Phantom 4 is that even though the switch on the controller was in ATI mode, if I switched off, changed battery, changed cards, and then relaunched, I'd need to reselect ATI. It would default back to using GPS. Okay, one other really important thing you need to factor into your flying is geozones. This is a really important thing to bear in mind because a lot of, say, small islands will have an airport on the island. Now, if you're planning on filming the ship coming into that island and you've got your drone out the back, say you're, 100 meters away with the drone, the ship may enter that geozone and then suddenly you've got no way of getting the drone back to the ship. So it's always worth looking at the geozone map on the app before you fly, just to see what you're going to encounter before you take off. Okay, so the other thing to really be cautious of is seagulls. If there's lots of seagulls around, I found that sometimes they can just really hate the drone. I said seagulls, stop it now. Also know how to use the map, how to locate not only your home point position, but the difference between that and your current position on the map, on the app, because learning that and seeing the direction your drone is facing and knowing how to fly to your position could also save the drone. So with most DJI drones, you can set them so that they either use the drone's location as the home point or the remote controller's location as the home point. Now, in order to use the remote controller, you do need to be using either a phone or a tablet or say a Crystal Sky that has GPS capabilities in order to do that. But you need to make sure that's working and that the tablet or the phone has GPS data before you start. Because what you want to do is when you take off, you need to keep updating your home point. For every minute of flight you do, the home point, the last home point that was set on the drone, is going to be moving further away. And that's going to cause you problems. You want to be updating your home point to your current location so that if, for instance, the drone were to briefly disconnect, it wouldn't just suddenly start flying to a point which is by now 5 miles away. You know, that's the last thing you need. So yeah, try and update your home point as you go. And in a moment, I will show you how that's done in the software. This video is getting so long now. Well done for getting this far. I thought now would be a good time to pop outside, get a bit of fresh air. I've got the Phantom with me, and we can get that set up, and I can show you guys how to go about updating the home point in the app to your current location. So let's get set up and I'll show you how that works. Okay, so I've set up this example. You can see the drone is currently ahead of me. The blue circle shows my location and the H in the green arrow shows the home point. Hopefully you can see that. So if I wanted to update the home point to my location, I just go into the menu here and then click on MC settings, and the second point down is literally choosing between the drone's current location and my location. So I'm going to select my location. It asks me to confirm and I say okay. And that's done. It says the home point's been updated. And now you can see the home point is currently where I am. It's worth reinforcing here that this setting does not continuously update your home point to the remote controller's position. You need to keep doing this process during the flight in order to not have the home point drift too far behind you. Okay, so with that, let's go into the DJI software and I'll show you some of the things that you need to think about and maybe consider changing before you fly your drone from a moving ship. So to begin with, let's go into the menu in the top right hand side with the three dots. This is the MC settings. So the first thing to pay attention to here is that enable intelligent flight modes is turned on, which enables you to use ATI mode, and also that beginner mode is turned off. And also that your return to home altitude is set correctly. Now you shouldn't be facing too many obstacles if you're flying at sea. So I tended to set mine around 50 meters, but that's really up to you. You need to base that depending on, you know, what's going to be a safe altitude. Also bear in mind that, you know, your drone is unlikely to be returning to home. If it does return to home, it's probably not going to be a good thing, but still worth considering setting that one. Okay, so the most important thing to look at on this page is distance limit. Now the reason for that is, if you update your home point to your current location, or even the remote control's current location, it's going to be moving away from you very quickly. Now, within a matter of minutes, the home point could be a kilometre, maybe 2 kilometres away. Now, if your drone is set with a distance limit, you know, the moment that home point reaches that distance limit, the drone's going to stop. It's not going to allow you to fly any further. The problem is, that's going to be moving further away from you. So turn that off. Don't use a distance limit at all. Let the drone fly an unlimited distance from the home point. So next you want to go into the advanced settings menu and then look for the RC signal lost options. You've got three options here. You've got return to home, landing, or hover. Now return to home will just send the drone back to the last home point where it will try to land, which is probably not a good thing over the sea. Then obviously the landing mode will just land where it is, again, not a good thing. And so I chose hover, because at least that way the drone will hover in its current location in the hope that you will regain signal, and then you can carry on bringing the drone back. Okay, so next we've got the sensors. Now, this is a kind of preference really, but for me, operating from a ship, I'd turn all the sensors off. I don't want any sensors interfering with the way the drone's handling or flying. There's going to be no more obstacles for the drone to fly around out at sea. So I turn all of those off. Okay, so in the advanced settings, you've got enabled downward vision positioning. I switched that off as well. That's kind of a personal preference. I mean, it could be that if you've got a good texture on the deck, that it may help the drone to hold position. But for me, I was hand catching. That wasn't really needed. And I'd prefer to know that the drone wasn't going to do something unexpected. So for me, I turn all of that stuff off. Okay, so the next important section to go to is the battery section. Now in here, you can set smart return home. Make sure that's turned off. Again, it's dependent on the distance between the drone and the recorded home point. If it detects that it needs to leave immediately in order to reach that home point with the remaining battery, it will do so. So switch that off. Now I set my low battery warning to the maximum, which is 50%. I'd recommend that as well. If you're flying and you fly down to 30% and then you run into a problem, things can get hairy quite quickly. So I'd recommend having your battery warning set to 50%. Also, critical battery warning set to a minimum. I mean, I set mine to 10%. You don't want to be flying your drone behind the ship or around the ship when it reaches critical battery. It will try and land. It will try and do automated things. You want to be landed well before that. So again, set your critical battery to 10%. But set your low battery warning to 50% and land as soon as it comes on. Give yourself plenty of time. Okay, so two other things that are really important. One is insure your drone. You know, this is a highly risky thing. There's a good chance this won't come back if you're flying from a moving ship. There's so much that can go wrong. And if you lose the drone and it's insured, then that really minimizes the financial impact. The other thing is to make sure you swap memory cards every flight. If you were to lose this, you know, it can be replaced. If you've lost the footage, you've wasted your shoot that day. So change cards whenever you get the opportunity. And then that way you're minimizing the risk to the loss of the footage as well. Now I'm going to be posting more videos soon to do with drones. So anything related to the Inspire 2 that I use for most of my commercial work, or the Phantom, if you have any questions, then please do ask. And if need be, I'll happily put a video together to explain things about that. So yeah, just feel free to leave some comments. And with that, I'll say goodbye and look out for more videos coming soon.